The title of today's message is Judge Not, Judge Not. And I think that the biggest problem with this phrase in Scripture, well, there are a couple of problems, but let me just stick to the basics for today. When the Bible speaks about judging not, right, lest you be judged. You guys know the passage, and it's addressed in other areas across Scripture. We're not talking about judgment as if someone broke the law or the moral code and should be judged, right, whether by a court of law, or about a court of those who are charged with looking after them. When it talks about judge not, it's again talking about, and I'm going to try to simplify it, it's talking about never coming into this place where you think you're doing it right when it comes to God. And others are doing it wrong. This is very deep. It's not only deep, but many don't want to delve deeply into this subject. Because, see, the issue is, judge not lest ye be judged. The moment you delve into this topic, it's going to unveil a lot about you and where you are. And about how you're not doing as well as you think you're doing when it comes to the Lord, to the things of the Lord. But I decided to take verses today, right? Just a few. I can't go too deeply, but I decided to take verses that are credited to our Lord, Jesus of Nazareth, who I consider the Christ. That's it. Only verses accredited. Powerful verses, but verses nonetheless accredited to Jesus. When we look at the book of John, John chapter 8, verse 7, it's very, very short, right? But it's very quick. John 8 and 7, it says, "Let he who is without sin cast the first stone." Well, right then and there, we all know how much we've broken this mandate, this law. Because for myself, for people like me, I can't speak for you, but for me, every time our Lord gave us a mandate, to me, it was a representation of the law. It was a representation of a commandment. It was something that I understood I had to strive to do, strive to accomplish. Let he who is without sin cast the first stone. And so we see that throughout Scripture, God warns against casting judgments upon others. So, and when we mean others, and we mean everybody according to their their way, their, you know, the way they worship, according to how they live, according to how they love, according to their socioeconomic standing, according to their skin color, according to their race. We should not be casting judgment. So then I said to myself, well, but there are areas in life that we have to really look into deeply. So I started to understand, as I continued to study scripture, that it was important for us to love and live and let live. But what worked for me is that I wanted to try to live a life knowing of my imperfections and knowing of my fallen nature, that I wanted to live a life where I was not hurting person, place, or thing. So I that's what worked for me. So I knew that I would not be perfect in this flesh, that I was of a fallen nature. But if I could strive to simply love others, to live my life to the fullest, and to let others live their lives to the fullest without hurting person, place, or thing. You know, when I see and I hear about our young people out there killing one another on the streets, I am able to judge. I am able to say that that is morally incorrect, that is not what God intended for our lives. I can do that. See how different that is than from me telling someone that they need to do things my way because my way is the best way, or that they need to look at topics across this life the way I look at them. So it's important that we understand that there are things out there that are incredibly crucial and incredibly sad and incredibly bad in the eyes of God. And then there are others that are not. And so we need to separate the two. We need to separate the two. Let's look at what the master says in Matthew chapter 25, verses 34 through 36. Interesting passage. It says, "Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world.' And then it continues, 'For I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in. I needed clothes and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. I was in prison and you came to visit me.'" So when you see these words from the master, it says, "Come and take your inheritance." And the reason you're going to take your inheritance is because you did what I told you to do, and you did A, B, C, D, E, which I just mentioned there. Fed the hungry, clothed those who needed clothing, gave to drink those who were thirsty, gave shelter to those who needed it, etc., etc. So the Lord speaks of inheritance because of these incredible things that you did. However, if we look at how we behave, We don't do a lot of these things. Not on a spiritual level and not in the physical. We just don't. We miss out on a lot of opportunities. And the reason that we miss out on a lot of opportunities is because our minds, right, our eyes are placed on areas that we should not be concerning ourselves with. So while you're concerning yourself as to how someone lives and loves, or you're concerning yourself with someone's skin color, you're concerning yourself with someone's race or whether they are documented or undocumented, or when you're spending your time trying to biblically justify things that you should not be concerning yourself with, is this particular person saved? Is this particular person not saved? Will they be saved since they're not doing it like me? Will I be not the one not to be saved? Am I the one doing it right? Am I the one doing it wrong? So as you take up all your time and your mind space, as I like to call it, with all these things that should not really concern you, the real work that needs to be done is not being done. The real work that will garner you your inheritance. Wow. Wow. What else does the Master say to us? In Mark chapter 12, Mark chapter 12, verses 30 and 31. It says, love the Lord your God with all your heart. There you go, right? So already we're failing. Love the Lord your God with all your heart. You know, and most of us give it about, I don't know, 25%? 25% of our hearts? Maybe less? 10% of our hearts? And yet God is expecting for us to love the Lord with 100% of our hearts. It says, with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind and your strength, He, God, is expecting 100% of you. What percentage of your life are you dedicating to the things of the Lord? I'll give you the answer. Very little. How about the second thing that the Lord told us to do? Love your neighbor as yourself. And the Lord ends this passage by saying, there is no commandment greater than these. So these two commandments really just represent all commandments and all the words of the prophets and all the writings. And we're failing at both. Not one, not the other, but both. Across the board, because we are doing things or involving ourselves in things that we need not. Because we are judging others in terms of how they worship, how they live. I'm not talking about people that are out there committing crimes. I'm not talking about that. You know very well what I'm talking about. And what this has done throughout our history and throughout the history before us is that it has pushed away so many people from wanting to seek God, from wanting to know God. Our behavior, right? Humankind's behavior and selfishness and competitiveness has pushed away so many, so many who were once seeking to know God. That is what we have gained. The fact that because we are unable to move forward, to expand our horizons, to move with the times in terms of our theology, to want to preach and teach knowing very little about Scripture, simply carrying forward what was once given to you by people who knew very little, you continue to push away the little ones, as the Bible calls them. It says it in Matthew's chapter 18, verse 6. If anyone causes one of these little ones, those who believe in me, to stumble, it would be better for them to have a large millstone hung around their neck and to be drowned in the depths of the seas. For the most part, when it comes to humanity, when we're born as little babes, we are taught by those who know more, right? We are educated, we are trained. It's like people who say, let's stop racism. Well, we need to stop it as children. We need to stop it as children. Racism, for instance, is something that is not, it just doesn't happen. It is taught, it is something learned. So it needs to start from when we are babes. It needs to start with our children. But I digress. We're talking about humanity. And humanity, as we grow, we are influenced by many things around us. And we are educated by many around us. But for the most part, if not for in its entirety, humanity is born right into this world seeking to know more, seeking knowledge, and in many cases seeking that greater being. And as we grow, we continue to seek that greater power, which some of us refer to as God. We are stumped by those around us because we are given this limited theology. And although as we grow, we seek more, we kind of become tainted. And so we think that we can do what we can, but we must maintain that initial theology as opposed to allowing ourselves to grow, to move forward, to not see the world and life through the eyes of others before us, those who influenced us, but to see it through our eyes, to come to our conclusions. We stick with what we were taught, and yet we refuse to delve deeper into Scripture, for instance, to seek out the greater mysteries within. We're set in our ways, and now we want to influence others to be set in our ways. Somehow we got it right, and others have gotten it wrong. And this causes so much confusion and disillusionment to the point where people can no longer hang out or hang on, and they walk away. They want nothing to do with that is spiritual, with that which we call God. Because we have pushed them away. We have caused them to stumble. It's as if everyone is born a believer, and because of our influence, they become unbelievers. We point at others and how they live, but we forget that as we point, you always have three digits pointing back towards you. And we waste so much time. We waste so much energy, energy that can be attributed, energy that can be placed into our personal relationship with God, into growing closer with God. We take that energy instead and use it elsewhere, where it doesn't help them and it doesn't help us. All you have to do is look at social media. All you have to do is look at social media and see where we're headed. Oh, people don't want to hear about God on social media. Very few. But you throw in some new dance step or some new rap that talks about, you know, murdering everybody. You throw in any of these other, you know, sexual implications. You throw in any of these topics, and the young, especially the young, are drawn to it. Some of the older people too, but the young are drawn to it like flies to garbage, if I may. People have lost their faith in the church. People have lost their faith in God. Because instead of doing what the Master told us to do in loving one another, we spend most of our energy, most of our time judging one another. And I'll finish with this. In John chapter 6, verse 39, these words are accredited to the Master. It says, "And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all those he has given me." Ah, powerful. Powerful. "And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall not lose any of those who he has given him." Now, if you are self-centered, which many are, if you are selfish, which many are, and you believe that the ones who were given to the Lord were those of a particular religious group, then you are lost. You are lost. See, it's like when we talk about, "I came to my own and my own rejected me." And throughout so many years, people used to tell me that what that meant was that he came to the Jews and the Jews rejected. And that's, and you know, and I would have been stuck with that theology if I didn't delve deeper into scripture, if I didn't start looking at God through my eyes, not through the eyes of my forefathers and foremothers. Because as I grew, I understood that it wasn't that he came to the Jews. He said, "I came to my own and my own rejected me." Who are his own? All those he created. So it means I came to my own. I came to those I created, and my creation rejected me. And not only did my not only did my creation reject me, but my creation continues to reject me even today. But the Lord says, and this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all those he has given me. His entire creation was given to him. All of creation was given to him. And he will not lose any of those. And I know that some of you will say, but Pastor, there's something in there that talks about children of perdition. And yeah, I understand that. But that's not... We are talking about those who have totally and implicitly rejected God. We are not talking about people who may worship differently than we do. We are not talking about people who may live differently than we do or love differently than we love. Or eat differently than we eat. All these things that we put in our way just to make things more complex. We're talking about his creation and how much he loves his creation across the board, God does. And now he is not planning to lose any of it. Some will be lost because of rejection. But not only in rejecting, but in behaving in a way that is not only rejecting, but it's in a way of alienating. I'll give you an example. I don't worry about atheists. I worry about anti-theists. Atheists, those who may believe that there is no God, most of them are really agnostic. They are not sure if God exists. And yet, this is their belief and they're not interested in pushing it on others. An atheist, an agnostic. An anti-theist, which is what we have to be very careful with, are with people who have rejected God, who don't believe that God exists, who in many instances hate the study of God and hate those who believe in God and will do everything in their power to cause destruction, to cause others not to believe in God, anti-theists. So don't confuse things. So we do have, scripture is very clear about children of perdition, but for the most part, we're talking about those that belong to God. No matter what state they may find themselves in. And so none of these will he lose. There's so much more that the Master shared. But when you look at these verses, and I hope you go back and look at them, you start to understand and you start to get a greater picture of what it means to share the gospel, to share the love, to do what the Master did. I had a person who asked me, but it says that we have to go and make disciples of them. What does that mean? To make disciples of them? To make them disciples of you? Or to get them to know more about who Jesus was and how he loved and how he treated people and with the hopes that they too will behave in such a way. And then we have those out there that are totally about just trying to convert people to their religious group, whatever that group may be. As if somehow they have some control over salvation when they have none. See, it's verses like this, and I like to go back and look at the Lord's words in the Aramaic translations directly from the Aramaic, as opposed to going from Aramaic, or Hebrew into the Greek and then back into English, and there could be a lot of lost in translation, if you know what I mean. But I go back and I try to study in translations directly from the Aramaic, and there's so much more to be learned. But we get to the point where we realize that God loves his creation across the board, and that we should join our Lord in this. Let us pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. May God bless you. May God keep you. You can always go ahead and look us up at actioninchrist.com. You can reach out to me at actioninchrist@gmail.com. And if you wish to catch this sermon, just the message portion, or the message portion of many of my past sermons, as well as other content, you can do so at my YouTube channel, Rev. Dr. Marcos Miranda. Rev. R-E-V. Dr. D-R. Marcos Miranda. You can look me up. And enjoy the Bible reading to help you sleep series. I think you'll enjoy that as well. So it's a beautiful day. Enjoy, and reflect on what you've heard. May God bless you. May God keep you. I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.